Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. So happy to be with you. Thank you for being with us. We appreciate that you take the time. And it's Ask a Priest, both hours today. Ask a Priest is like open forum, but with a bonus. Like you get to ask, you know, more pastoral questions. If you got a question about your prayer life, maybe, or you got a question about, oh, the family life or sacramental life or, did I say marriage already? Any of those, you're welcome. Yeah, 888-318-7884, the number. And our guest both hours is the estimable Father Hugh Barbour. Is that a good modifier, estimable?
Estimable, yes. Well, all right. It's usually say inestimable.
Inestimable
means,
yeah, it's like
able
flammable.
To be reckoned.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Inestimable means beyond reckoning.
Yes.
So it depends on what you meant to say.
I meant to say beyond reckoning. So okay. Inestimable.
There you go.
And another reason that you are inestimable.
I have to make sure my compliments are properly
That's
spoken.
Right. You got to vet your compliments.
That's right, exactly.
Father is the former prior of St. Michael's Abbey up in Orange County and a Norbertine canon. And... That's right.
That's right.
Norbertine canon. And what else am I supposed to say? Graduate of St. Thomas Aquinas. No, Aquinas. What's the one, the Angelicum?
Right. I have a doctorate in the Angelicum, right.
Yeah.
Right.
But you never like to talk about the degrees. And you're like, oh, no. We don't worry about the
degrees.
Well, I mean,
whatever. I mean, I have them.
Doctorate from the Angelicum.
Yes, right. License in Petrology from the Patristic Institute in Rome, the Augustinianum.
Wow.
And I went to UNC Chapel Hill, the Tar Heels.
And that's
in classics.
Right.
MBA, so.
So, basketball. Augustine.
Yes, you can tell.
Augustine and Aquinas.
Right, exactly.
The three most important things in life. Well, among the most important things in life. 888-318-7884, our number. Thank you so much for coming to do 2 hours, because last time we did Ask a Priest, it felt so brief with just an hour, mm-hmm, because so many people call and have questions. So thanks for doing it.
Happy to.
And everything is well at the Abbey? Anything you want to report from the Abbey? Just that you have a big, giant new church up there.
Beautiful, yeah. Beautiful new monastery, yeah.
Uh-huh.
It's true. Lots of vocations. 10 new postulants this week. 9 new postulants came.
Really?
Yes, they come in the last week of August.
And where do they come from? Like, where are your postulants from?
All over,
from?
Let's see. This year, from Texas, from Connecticut, from California, of course. Where else? Anyway, from all around.
Well, that's really cool. That's fantastic.
That's plenty, right.
Yeah.
Luckily, we have room now because we have the new abbey, so there's room for everybody.
So what does a postulant wear? Like, you all wear white.
Wear a little black suit, you know.
Oh, they wear a little black suit.
Yeah, they wear a big black suit if they're tall, right.
Oh, a big black suit. Okay.
Right. Depending upon their size, you know.
Yeah, right, because I could never be a postulant if you have to wear a little black suit.
Oh, if you and I became postulants today, we would be in tip-top shape.
By the time we're done?
By the time we took the habit.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
Really? Because
I need to be.
What do you have them doing? What do they do? They have to do manual labor?
They do a lot of that, too.
Do they really?
And also, they're young, so the pounds drop off.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Like, would a postulant wash the dishes and that kind of thing? Or like?
They would sometimes, yeah.
That's
good
for you.
But they take classes, though, and do manual labor and all kinds of things. Walk the dogs, yeah.
Wait a second. I didn't know there were dogs. I'm learning so much about St. Michael's
Abbey.
It's
enormous property, so you have to have dogs around. With wild animals around.
Oh, so the dogs keep the wild animals away.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Are these like little terriers that are trying to keep
No, these are nice, like flock type dogs. I can't remember the name of the breed, but they're very intelligent.
Uh-huh.
If you drive the car by, they try to shepherd the car, you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You just said they're very intelligent.
They are.
And then you said they try to shepherd the car.
Well, you know,
they
want to make sure you stay within the...
They seem really intelligent, Father.
You notice how dogs run right in front of cars and keep looking back? That's their shepherding instinct.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know
They're keeping it in bounds, yeah.
When we took our little children to the beach, we had a dog that used to panic when they got in the waves and try to shepherd them out of the beach.
Right, of course.
And she'd hurt them. Like, she'd, like, scratch them. This is not safe. Get out of here.
Yeah.
So we put her down. No, that's not true. It's only a joke.
No, please don't say that.
I'm just teasing.
Mama Mia.
We love that dog. That was our kid's dog. 888-318-7884. I'm so glad you're back, Father.
Richard Gorey or something, yeah.
In Utah, watching on Facebook Live, is going to be first. Hi, Bryce from
Hello,
Utah.
Bryce.
Hey, Cy. Hey, Father.
Hello.
Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
And Father, you played a large role in my conversion, so thank you for all your work.
Oh, really? Well, God bless you.
I have a friend who's actually considering becoming Catholic, and he's looking at joining RCIA this fall. Uh-huh. He's from a Seventh-day Adventist background, so to do this, he'd have to change his day off of work from Saturday to Sunday, mm-hmm. which is a big deal for him. So he was wondering why we don't observe the Sabbath day on Saturday, because it's one of the Ten Commandments. So I'm planning on sending this clip to him. So if you could bless me with some wisdom, then that would be very appreciated.
Certainly. Well, of course, in a sense, we do observe the Sabbath because Saturday is always the Sabbath. It's even called Sabbato, Sabbatum in Latin and in Latin languages. So Sunday is not, strictly speaking, the Sabbath. That's correct. The Sabbath is the seventh day, the day when God rested, making the world. And that is the day of rest and worship in the Old Covenant, in the Mosaic Law. And but with the Christian law, which of course removed the ritual precepts of the Mosaic Law, leaving only the moral precepts, but the ritual precepts were removed, the Christian church began to celebrate the weekly day of worship of God and of rest on Sunday, because that's the day on which our Lord rose from the dead. And there's a symbolic reason, too, because the precepts of the Old Law, the liturgical precepts, they prefigured heavenly things, but they were within the context of the world of creation that God made, namely of this world. So God makes the world in 6 days, and then there's a day of rest. But the eighth day, the so-called eighth day, which is the full octave, all right, that's Sunday, so-called. It's called the eighth day. And that's the day which symbolizes eternity, everlasting life. And so in Christian worship, the precept to worship God and to take time off in order to worship Him, which is a basic moral precept, was changed liturgically from Saturday to Sunday, symbolizing our faith in the resurrection of the Lord, and also that resurrection meaning the eternal life, the so-called eighth day, which goes on forever and ever. That's the early Christian tradition there. And we see it in the scriptures. Of course, Seventh Adventists have arguments against our defense of Sunday, but clearly in the Apocalypse, where the St. John the Divine is having a liturgical vision. You know, he says he was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, and in the context of this liturgy, you know, with the seven candlesticks and all that, he sees what he sees. And so it's the solemn day of the liturgy of the Christians. It wasn't as though in the beginning there weren't some differences. There were various degrees early on of a quasi-observance of the Sabbath among Christians from a Semitic background or the original Jewish Christians, so that they observed Sunday, yes, but they also had some kind of Saturday observance. And that survives in the Ethiopian Rite, for example, and little touches of it also added in later in the liturgies of the Byzantine Rite and others, but not in terms of the rest observance, but in terms of liturgically aware that that's the prefiguration of the Sunday. And of course, in the Latin Church, the Roman Church, they developed the custom of dedicating Saturday to the veneration of Mary. Now, and Mary, in her role, you know, the Jews sing these psalms about God's role in creation, His creation of the world, His wisdom in the world, on the Sabbath day. And Our Lady is identified with that. She's the created ideal for what God intended in creating the world, to create it so that from the world would come this woman who would give birth to God's only Son, bringing the world beyond the world into eternal life. So there is a veneration for Saturday, you could say, in the veneration of Our Lady. In the Eastern churches, they use Saturday to commemorate the departed, because it's the day of our Lord's descent among the dead to the place of rest and waiting. And so there's also a kind of Saturday observance there. But our worship and our rest are for Sunday, because we want to emphasize heaven and the gifts of heaven, eternal life. I hope that's sufficient to give the positive side of the argument.
Okay, Bryce?
That sounds great. I'll send it to him and pray for him.
Sure, absolutely. God bless.
Hey, Bryce, I'd also like to send you, I don't know if you have to decide if he would be interested in this, but Tim Staples did probably the definitive Catholic response to Seventh-day Adventism.
Right, exactly. Very good, yeah.
It's a CD set, or you can get it in MP3. It's called The Great Disappointment. And so if you want it, so that you can share it with your friend, just hang on the line, and they'll get it for you.
Yeah, that's very good. You might give them my answer first, and then if they have questions, give them
The Great Disappointment.
Great Disappointment, so that it goes more into depth. Because it's true, I have not studied deeply the whole Seventh-day Adventist approach, but I'm giving you the positive approach of why we do it.
Sunday worship.
So you just hang on, Bryce, if you'd like to get that. Sure. We'll send it out to you. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Ask a Priest with Father Hugh Barbour right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
I still have my sanity because of EWTN and listening to your station. Everybody needs to listen to positive things. If you only listen to the negative things, it just gets very bad. If it weren't for your uplifting and wonderful people that conduct your programs, I don't know if I could still be not crying.
EWTN, helping people grow in their love and understanding of God.
Catholic Answers Live. Hey, the whole entire set of 20 Answers books is now 47 books, and all kinds of them, including a very a beautiful little book on blessings. Did you know we have a 20 Answers book on blessings?
Oh, really? Wonderful.
Yeah.
That's good.
You know, you're one of the two people that wrote it.
Did I really?
Yeah.
Oh, it's on prayer.
Prayer. But it has blessings in it.
Yes,
oh,
it has blessings in it. Yeah, I was going to say, I don't remember that. You could easily do that, yes.
Oh, I'm so sorry, Father.
No, it's all right.
I had the blessings in my head, but it was on prayer, yes. But 47.
You're forgiven.
Oh,
I bless you.
Oh, thank you.
We all make mistakes.
You forgive easily. So, yes. That's a virtue, to forgive easily.
It is.
65% off when you buy the whole set of 47 books. Get a great education. 20 Answers books at shop.catholic.com. Shop.catholic.com. Father Hugh Barbour is our guest, and you are welcome to call and ask whatever you'd like. By the way, if you're not a Catholic and you have a question that you'd like to ask a Catholic priest, you're very welcome. If you're not a Christian, you're very welcome. 888-318-7884. Robert in Cincinnati, Ohio, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. You are next. Go ahead, Robert, with your question for Father Hugh Barbour.
Hi, y'all. My employer has mandated unconscious bias training.
Oh, dear.
And a basic tenet of it is that all persons at all times are possessed of unconscious biases and prejudices, which drive their actions. And that seems to me very anti-Catholic, because I think that as long as we are in sanctifying grace, as long as we have sanctifying grace and remain in God's friendship, our intellect is enlightened and our will is strengthened, not perfectly, but as much as we can in this life. Can a Catholic ascribe to that idea?
Well, of course, the thing is, you can ascribe to something, but not that idea as it is presented nowadays. Let me just put it very simply. The irony of that is, you know, everybody has implicit biases at all times, except the people that say you have implicit biases.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So it's one of those, you know, all animals are equal, but some animals are more equal than others.
Oh, that's,
you
know, 75 years old this
right,
week.
Right,
that
there
book,
it is.
Animal,
yeah, animal
Farm.
It's that totalitarian thinking which has come in. It's true that a prudent man, you're talking about grace and the life of virtue, a prudent man who seeks self-knowledge and seeks to be virtuous, which means to be charitable and to judge truly and to speak truly, will be careful that the things he says are based upon what can be held to be true, and not just say or do things because he has a feeling that that's the way it is, or has a prejudice which is not backed up by prudent understanding, you know? And so that the problem is that we live in a world now where, of course, there's no notion of sin, and so if there are any evils in the world, there have to be people who are basically unconsciously evil in order for evils to come about, because they can't perceive that a good intention is sufficient to make our actions good, at least up to a point, and that it's certainly a good intention is enough for others not to judge your intentions as evil or immediately judge your actions as evil. And so this is being used as a way of making people give up their traditional attachment to traditional morality, to traditional view of sex roles and whatnot. And of course, they use the racial bias as the model. But even then, it's basically a kind of secular original sin. You're responsible for all the acts of prejudice or injustice that were ever committed by a member of your race against every other. And so there's an imputation to you as a person for something you never really did. And our doctrine of original sin doesn't even do that. It just means your first parents lost what they had, and so you don't have it either. But that's very different from saying that you're infected personally and morally and going to be punished and treated accordingly because of this past defect of your ancestors. You know, God is a just judge, and men sometimes aren't. So I would just say you can go along with the training if it's sufficient to keep your job, and you prudently can put up with it. But these people that run these things are very rarely open to any kind of questioning of the whole process because it's very ideological. And so unless they're really innocent or really reasonable, they're not going to be interested in your saying, I don't think this really is good. So you have to be, you know, have to consider that taking those classes wouldn't be sinful because you'd be informing yourself about something that's going on in our society, but you would be sure that at least you yourself don't say things you don't think are true, basically, like you don't sin against the truth. So if they ask your opinion, you can make objections, but you don't have to, like, go to the mat over it necessarily, depending on the circumstances. But, yeah, does that help at all?
It does. I think so. Very early on in the training, after a few minutes, you're given a question to which you have to provide answers. And at that point, I stopped taking it because none of the answers were true. And so I've been assigned someone to provide re-education to me. And I guess I'm going to say, so my employer is saying that Our Lady had unconscious biases she acted on. And let them answer that question. Because everybody at all times means everybody at all times.
Yeah. Well, you could just argue that obviously it's a matter of degree, and some biases are reasonable and some are not. You know, like you want to protect your children from physical harm, and that's a thing you're conscious of at every moment of the day when your children are around, and that's an unconscious bias that affects your immediate instinctive behavior, but it's not bad. You know, so I mean, you have to say, well, what biases are we looking at? You know, a bias that'll make me be unjust or cruel or violent to someone, or a bias that will help me to protect or defend or help someone. You know, not all biases are equal, if you know what I mean.
No, right? Of course not.
Yeah.
Robert, thanks. It's a tough one.
Yeah, it's horrible what's going on.
And I know there are, I'm sure there are very many good trainings out there, but when it sounds like Robert has one of those where it's not just that you have to hear what we have to say, but you have to think what we tell you to think.
Yeah,
and that's disturbing when the society gets to that point. But I think there's a lot of people who are choosing not to fight the battle, to just sit there through the training and move on and do the next thing.
Yeah, well, again, it's a question of prudence. There are injustices that we can endure willingly, even though we know they're unjust, as long as we're not hurting somebody else and you're just judging, no, I need to keep my job, and my job doesn't require me to tell lies, so I'll just be quiet. But I mean, this is we're back in the world where, you know, that we're in a world similar to what other people have endured through a whole 20th century of a society.
Oh, right. And you know, I mean,
people that lived
in
the Soviet Union or in authoritarian and totalitarian regimes, they had to deal with this stuff all the time, and they still had to support their family and whatnot. And we're getting to that point because this degree of thought control is right there. But the church has never told people that they all have to go out and just not have work and not be able to support their family because they have to fight on every little point. Sometimes it's good just to be quiet and survive. But that's a prudential judgment. It's not easy.
Yeah, right. And it's a hard one too, because in one place there's a lovely training being done. In another place it's some maniacal, you know, thought. I don't know, control.
No, and it's true.
And so you don't know what, it's hard to give a general answer, because sometimes it's like, well, actually, maybe you should listen to that.
Yeah, but
you know?
Like in some companies, they might have a training on boundaries.
Yeah.
And those can be very, very good. You can find out that the things that you have been saying or doing that you don't realize the effect it has on other people.
Right.
And a good man wants to know if his words or behavior are troubling to someone else.
Right.
But when you're being told that you are condemned before you even begin the discourse,
that's
problem. And that we're going to prove to you that you're bad, and that your ancestors are bad, and that all your cultural presuppositions are bad, and that you can't say, no, that's not true. Like, you're not allowed to speak back, you know.
That's, yeah, then we're into crazy territory.
We're into Twitter and Facebook cancellation. That's what we are.
Yeah. Rebecca. First of all, Robert, thank you very much for the call. We appreciate it. Rebecca in Cleveland is next, listening on 1260 AM, The Rock in Cleveland. Go ahead, Rebecca, with your question for Father Hugh Barbour.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you for taking my call very much. So I am a Catholic high school theology teacher, and I get a lot of really interesting questions. Some of them I really have a hard time answering. But right now we're starting with talking about baptism, sacramental grace, and it got to the point where my kids just are like, well, if there is mercy at the end of our lives, if at the end of our lives we can get to this place and say, wow, I was wrong, and, you know, I need to repent, and the Lord accepts us in that mercy, which we hope he does, then they're just basically asking, like, what's the point of baptism, and why do we live morally good lives if at the end of our life we can just say, I'm sorry.
Yep, that's it. Well, first of all, God bless you for being in the classroom teaching the faith of Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
These scrappy kids, you know, they're just like adults.
Only worse.
They find excuses for everything. I would say, well, you look at it this way. Say, well, what if your mother said, no matter what, I'll always love you. And no matter what you do, I'll always forgive you. And so you took her words literally, and so you mistreated her, offended her, cheated her, defamed her, ignored her, neglected her, were cruel to her your whole life, because you knew that she would always love you and always forgive you. And so finally she's on her deathbed, and how are you going to feel when you look at her and you go, I mistreated this woman my whole life, and she still loves me, and now she's dying? And then consider that and look at the crucifix, and there you have Jesus dying for your sins, and dying even in the face of people who will say, well, you know, if God's mercy is that available, then I can just keep doing the horrible things I'm doing. I'll just keep him up there.
Yeah.
Just nail away, you know, whip away, crown of thorns away, blaspheme away. So they need to see Jesus as a person, as one who loves them and whom they want to please, because he's so good and he wants their eternal salvation. He takes them seriously. And so that's the first thing is, you know, after all, what he did in order that we might have the grace of the sacraments, they all flow from his precious blood, from his suffering on the cross. Then you can also say, what's to guarantee that if you get in such habits of sin that suddenly you're just going to be sorry on the day you die? Believe me, people die who are not sorry for their sins, and who say they're not sorry for their sins, and who don't want to be absolved. And there was a time in their life where they would have been. And that's a very terrifying thing. And not only that, so you wait to your deathbed. Okay. Well, there's also purgatory, you know. I mean, come on. You know, if we want to be happy, we should get ready for death. And God is merciful, and he might forgive at the very last moment, and will forgive. St. Faustina has beautiful considerations about how our Lord works on souls even at the very end, and especially hard. And we have the good thief as an example. But really, honestly, just think of Jesus hanging on the cross, and then think of anyone else you might love that you would take their undying love for you as an excuse for mistreating them, and you'll see what's wrong with that. That's what I would tell them.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yeah,
sure.
That's great. Thanks.
Okay. God bless.
Rebecca, since you're a teacher and all, do you have any of our books? Because I'd be happy to send you.
I don't I don't think so. I'm on your website quite frequently, the Catholic Answers website. So
yeah.
I don't think I have any books, so.
Well, I'll tell you what. If there's one that you want, I'll put you through to Thomas, and we'll send it to you, because you're doing the Lord's work.
That's right.
Is there one you want, or do you want me to suggest one? Because I can put you...
If you could suggest one, that would be awesome.
Purgatory is for Real? That's, I don't know, you mentioned Purgatory.
Yeah, well, that's certainly a good one.
All right, we got one on Purgatory.
Yeah. Our brilliant
Carlo. Anything about dogs going to heaven?
Anything about dogs going to heaven? Oh, don't send her any books by Carlo.
Does he think...
No, he's really tough on dogs going to heaven.
There is an answer to that one, but...
Well, we do have material on that on our website, but let's send you Carlo's book, Purgatory is for Real.
There's also a difference of opinion about it, too.
Yeah, there is. Hang on, Rebecca. We'll figure out what book to send you. We've got to send you something, because you're a good one.
Thanks, Rebecca.
We'll be right back with more Father Hugh Barbour right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers is doing it again. We're holding our 7th annual Apologetics Conference this September in beautiful San Diego, California, and we'd like to see you there. Join us September 23rd to 26th for a lively and inspiring conference with an all-star lineup of speakers guaranteed to jumpstart your faith. It's a great chance to meet all your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and very special guests as we spend 4 days talking about worshiping and adoring our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is where it all begins. Don't miss what promises to be the event of the season. Join us this September for a conference that is sure to ignite, inspire, and inform your faith. Seats are still available, but they're going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 888-291-8000 to register.
Dr. David Anders here. Where is purgatory in the Bible? Why confess my sins to a priest?
Find out more tomorrow at 2 p.m. Eastern on Call to Communion.
Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. It's Ask a Priest this hour, and Father Hugh Barbour is our guest. 888-318-7884 is our number. Rebecca in Cleveland, who teaches theology to high schoolers, is getting her book right now from Thomas. But Peggy came in during the break and said, why don't you give her The Truth Is Out There, our graphic novel, one of the three graphic novels we have, which is great for kids. And so we're going to give her that. She can leave that in her classroom. And maybe if you have a teacher that you like and they'd like something, some reading material for their students, give them that. The Truth Is Out There.
It's got great theological and philosophical content.
But then we gave her a choice on any other Catholic Answers book she wanted for herself, so she can pick. And everybody on Facebook thinks I didn't offer her my book about Jesus because no one ever takes my book, and that they thought that was going to hurt my feelings. But it was only because you mentioned Purgatory that I suggested Purgatory is for Real. I'm not afraid of giving my book away.
No.
As a matter of fact, people can buy my book, two copies for the price of one right now at shop.catholic.com.
They should buy it because it's very, very good and it's very well written.
Please,
it's very well written.
Really,
yes.
Father?
Yes, absolutely.
That's lovely of you to say.
No, it's not some kind of corny spiel. It's really good.
Well, I really appreciate you saying
I'm
that.
Telling
Thank you.
That.
If it was a corny spiel, I would appreciate it. But you saying it's
no,
not
it's
a corny spiel.
It's very, very good. It's the kind of book you could listen. Someone could read it to you, and you could listen to it, and get. That's how well written it is. It's written so that you could actually listen to someone reading it to you.
I am having the best day right now.
Well, it's true,
because you said
though.
Those nice things about my book. Because I just wanted to write a good book about Jesus, you know?
Right.
Because I love him.
Well, he gave you the means in your noggin and heart to write it. So I'm just saying. Buy a copy. Or two.
Two for the price of one right
Refuse
now.
Refuse to pay for two for the price of one. Two for the price of two.
By the way, I want to say something else before I go to another caller. Since you said that was very nice of you to say those things.
That's it wasn't just nice. It was true what I said.
Well,
it was not based on implicit bias. It was true.
I very much appreciated you offering Mass today for the souls of all those who gave their lives in the war in Afghanistan.
Yeah,
I thought today was a lovely day to offer a Requiem Mass, and it felt really great to pray for all
thousands
those who gave their lives in defense of us and in love for this country. Yeah. So thank you, Father, for doing that.
And the last ones to die there who died really protecting people from harm.
I know.
Those 13, goodness.
Right, but God does not forget that they were protecting others.
And we have to remember, too, as tragic as their deaths would be, they don't want to come back.
No, they got their reward now.
They don't want to come back.
For what they did.
Yeah, they're happy to be safe now.
Praise God.
And so we pray for the repose of their souls.
Ashley in Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. Because what else are you going to do? Spirit Catholic Radio all over Nebraska. Go ahead, Ashley.
Hello, thank you. Well, I just had a quick question. Kind of weighed on my heart for a while. I, years ago, took a friend of mine who was a pastor for an E-Free Churches. It was his son. Came to Mass with me because he's always was evangelizing me. So I was always trying to get him to become Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted to come with me to a Mass, and so he came with me. I was very, very, very clear that he could not have communion. I even showed him that very nicely worded intro in the hymnal, like the first page that discusses that. And so when communion time came, he let me go first very kindly. I went up. I didn't see him behind me, but then after I took communion, I realized he did as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess my question is, what, as a Catholic, like if I'm bringing somebody and I know this person is not a Catholic, should I have intervened? Should I have like said something to the priest as I was walking away and realized what he was about to do? Or what should I do in that situation if it would ever arise again?
No, well, you did what a Catholic is supposed to do. You informed him correctly, and then he chose not to follow your direction or the direction, the statement from the bishop's conference about intercommunion in the missalettes or the hymnals. And you could, if you're going with him regularly, you could alert the priest about it. But even then, if he just comes up, the priest is not going to refuse him communion because it's not some notorious, well-known thing. So, you know, he would be given communion anyway because it's not a source of scandal or marvel on the part of the faithful present. And so what you do is you just tell him that he shouldn't. But I would say the best thing to do, and this is for anyone that's going to bring a non-Catholic friend to Mass, is that most people will do as you as direct. But instead of putting it negatively, have a little form of spiritual communion on a little card or something. My Jesus, I cannot now receive you in the sacrament, but I ask you to come to my heart. And, you know, some prayer like that. And give that to them and say, well, when I go up to communion, then you can pray this and just hand it to them. And maybe that would be sufficient to give them something positive to do in that time rather than feeling awkward or thinking that they would just want to go up. That's what I would suggest you do, is just show them an act of spiritual communion and say that's what you're supposed to do. But if he's baptized and in the state of grace, let's just say that his going to communion, even against the rules, is certainly not going to hurt him, because he probably doesn't have a bad intention. He has a good intention. He feels like, well, I'm a Christian and I love Jesus. So I want to go to communion. Well, if you're baptized Christian, then he does receive the sacramental effect, even though he may not be yet in the church. It's a disciplinary matter of the church. This baptism would automatically kind of give you access to the Holy Eucharist. But since he's not in full communion with the Catholic Church, we have that discipline that they are not permitted to receive until they are. And that's to protect the sacrament and also to make sure they're well instructed. But in and of itself, if he if he, you know, he could go to Catholic Church any time and go to communion and he wouldn't even know it. And this does happen. You shouldn't worry that it's going to harm him or that he's necessarily sinning by doing that. Actually, he may receive grace from it, you know, accidentally, but there it is. You know, if something's good, it's good. So just admonish the person not to go to communion and give them something good to do in the meantime, and then leave it up to our Lord, who may be drawing his heart. Let's hope he is. Yeah.
Ashley, what do you think?
Amen.
Okay.
Amen. Yes. Well, my next question was, do you think I should go to confession for that? But I think I have my answer in your answer.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You did what you could do. Yeah.
No, I think you did a lot more than many of us Catholics do. You inviting a brother Christian to consider the Catholic faith and come to church. I think what you did. I don't know. I know you didn't call and ask for my opinion, but I'm kind of an admirer of yours now, Ashley.
Mm. Oh, well, thank you. I'm very much an admirer of everyone at Catholic Radio and especially Catholic Answers, so thank you.
Thank you.
God bless you.
I'm glad you said especially Catholic Answers, too, because not everybody at Catholic Radio is our... I'm just kidding. Sorry, I got to stop.
People may not understand
that I'm joking.
Yeah.
No, I know. Sometimes people don't understand that I'm joking, and nowadays they send me a note, and then they get very mad at me. But, I mean, you know.
Yeah, it's the way things are now. People get very little reminded.
Yeah, and sometimes I would say a good 75% of the time the jokes are not funny either. So you know, you're only hitting on 25% of them.
Yeah, so they're funny. Okay, well, let's get down to business here.
Anonymous in Florida watching on YouTube. You are next. Go ahead, Anonymous.
Hello.
Hello.
I have a struggle with scrupulosity for a long time, years actually, where I've been obedient to God, but I haven't been able to receive communion because of a scrupulosity with confession, believing that mistakes could lead me to commit sacrilege and things like that. So in the later moment, like right now, I finally arrived to the following situation. I know that I have to confess all the sins and not neglect any of that, and I am perfectly willing to do it. And I have experienced two moments lately. One, I made a full list of notes of my sins throughout all my life, but it's like 20 pages, right? When that happened, I realized I kind of got healed of a scrupulosity by realizing that you know, that was not the way to go. I should have been more not so exhaustive. So, but now I have this giant list with memories to examine to probably identify more mortal sins and potential mortal sins. So it's a huge list that now that I am more balanced with the scrupulosity, I will say more healed. I don't know, many people have advised to me that I could disregard that list, like kind of, I don't know, throw it to the sea or make like it doesn't exist and try to come up with a shorter, more reasonably, more easy list.
Yeah.
Because my intent is perfect. It's just that my issue is coming up with a list that is in harmony with what the catechism asks you, which is do not neglect to say any sin.
Okay, but Joseph, I'm going to let Father give a little bit of advice here, and then we'll come back to you and see if that's... Do you have advice for it?
Yes. You are...
I said Joseph. That's our next caller, Anonymous.
You say, beloved Anonymous. That's your name, Anonymous.
I was on to the next caller.
Saint Anonymous. I'm sure there's a Saint Anonymous somewhere. Thank you for just going to the trouble. How many of us would have gone to that ground of trouble to go over all the sins of our life? It's good to make a general confession sometimes, but not if you're scrupulous. And so... consider this. We are bound to confess mortal sins committed after baptism. That's the strict matter for confession, where you need to go to confession before receiving Holy Communion, is if you have a mortal sin or mortal sins committed after baptism. Now, the question of mortal sin, it doesn't mean something that could be a mortal sin under any circumstances. It means that you subjectively, with full knowledge, full consent of the will and reflection, committed the sin, knowing it to be grave. Now, so that narrows the scope a great deal, because sad to say, we commit many sins which could have been mortal had we been completely conscious or aware or deliberate about it. But very often, thanks be to God, that's not the case. And so we're not really fully guilty of a mortal sin. And I give you this image, and it's a very true one. You could not physically die, without knowing that you had died. If you were knocked dead, you wouldn't be lying on the ground saying to yourself, am I dead or not? Oh. Not very likely. If you're dead, you're going to know you're dead. Okay. Now, mortal sin is spiritual death. It means that you so consciously and deliberately offend God so as no longer to be in a relationship, a friendship with Him. And therefore, it's impossible, practically speaking, there are some extreme cases, but you're not one of those, it's impossible to commit a mortal sin and then sit there and go, did I or didn't I? Did I or didn't I? Did I commit a mortal sin? Did I not commit a mortal sin? A mortal sin, if you committed it, on first reflection, you would see that that's what that was.
Yeah.
You would know it. You would not die spiritually and not know that you'd done it. Look at King David when he's finally confronted with his sins, and he writes the beautiful Psalm 50 or 51, it depends on the Bible you're using, of repentance for his sins. He conceived a deep contrition when he became aware that he had offended God, and very, very deliberately and viciously. So that's what we go to confession for. The other sins that we can confess in confession, that is, that are called the free matter of confession, are lesser sins. We're encouraged to confess those because we bring down the sacramental grace on those sins as well, or those weaknesses of ours as well. But as far as mortal sins go, it's just impossible that you have many, many possible mortal sins, because you only have mortal sins to confess when you know that you committed a mortal sin. Now, the others you can confess freely and say, you could even tell the priest, I don't know if this is a mortal sin or not, whatever, confession is not made to be a form of moral torture. It's meant to be our way of expressing our loving sorrow for sin, on which God pours out the blessing of His pardon, and if our sorrow is too weak, He perfects our sorrow in that sacrament so that we have our sins completely forgiven. So, that's what I'm saying, basically. A doubtful sin is not a mortal sin. And you can wipe your forehead and go, whoosh, that was a close one. And it's a warning not to play around with certain things if you did it indeliberately or without full consent. But you can't commit a mortal sin. You can't die spiritually and not know you're dead. If you're a practicing Catholic, you can't know you're dead, you know. So I think that's the thing, is just confess the ones that you just really know. And if you don't know for sure, then just stick with that shorter list.
Anonymous, I have to go to a break, so I'm going to leave it there. But I'm going to put you on hold, and I'd like to send you Father Hughes and Father Sebastian Walsh wrote a book on prayer, 20 Answers Prayer. I'll send that to you. And if we can be helpful again, call back again. We got to go to a break. We'll be right back with more Ask a Priest on Catholic Answers Live.
God bless.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
This is Bernadette Boguski, Executive Director of WCCR Cleveland, AM 1260 The Rock. Why do we need Catholic radio? To reach the hearts, minds, and souls of those who are searching for deeper meaning and don't know where to turn. To bring clarity to a world full of lies and confusion. And to share the good news of joy and mercy with a world so desperate for the truth.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio. Now, more than ever.
Ah!
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Father Hugh Barbour, our guests for both hours today, Ask a Priest, and as happens when Father Hugh is here, lots of folks on the line. So I will continue on. Joseph in Tennessee, listening on the new and improved Catholic Answers Live app. Joseph, go ahead with your question for Father.
Hey, how are you doing, Father and Cy?
Hey.
Hi, Joseph.
Hey. Hi. First off, I'd love to say I love the show, and Cy, I'm really looking forward to your book. It's on my wish list. It's Teacher of Strange Things, so feel bad that people aren't buying it. I'm looking forward to getting it.
I think we're about to tick something off your wish list, Joseph. Hank, we'll see how you do, though. We got to see how your question goes for Father.
Okay.
Yeah, make sure I give a good answer, otherwise...
Yeah. Good, Father. I was just looking at so we live in a world full of relativism, and we have these youth that get out into the real world and they leave the faith pretty quickly after going to college or getting out of their homes. And I'm trying to find some good reading material or books that I can get to give to our youth group at our local parish to prepare them for the world and for that relativistic nature of our society.
Well, of course, there are lots of things that they could read. I'm thinking you're talking about the kind of kids that would actually read something.
Yes.
Yeah, good.
Yes,
okay. Because, I mean, it's kind of like not everyone reads nowadays. And I'm a little old-fashioned. I'm going on what was helpful for me and what I've given to people myself. Frank Sheed, who was one of the original lay apologists in the Catholic Church, and certainly, and easily you could argue, the greatest, practically speaking. I mean, he's sort of the one that started the whole movement in the 20th century. He wrote a succession of books about the faith. He has one that's called A Map of Life, which is a little overview of the Catholic faith, very reasonable. And then there's a next one that goes a little more deeply that's called Theology for Beginners. And then the next one, which is called Theology and Sanity. And those go progressively deeper into an understanding of the teaching of the church and of the creed, basically. And then he also has a Society and Sanity as well on the church's social teaching. But I would say if they're readers, they could start with the Map of Life and go to Theology for Beginners and then Theology and Sanity, and they would have a really good formation. In fact, a lot of priests, if they just read Frank Sheed, they'd have good theology. They could chuck everything else practically, you know, if they didn't get good theology.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
Those are ones I recommend. And then on a non-Catholic side, just to see the reasonableness of it, C.S. Lewis's Mere Christianity, and with a little caveat that it's not Catholic, but it presents the fundamental notions of the faith in a very lucid way, convincing way, because they're going to run across Protestants that might need that kind of reading. And it introduces some serious theological thinking. And then another one on the moral order called The Abolition of Man, a little tiny treatise by C.S. Lewis about morality. Okay. And it's only about 90 pages long. So those are things I would tend to recommend, but I'm sure that Catholic Answers has wonderful works by apologists that would also be helpful as well.
And specifically on relativism, we have Carlo's CD on relativism, where Your Truth, My Truth is an answer to relativism. And I would send you that one, Joseph, but what do you think of Father's recommendations?
Oh, that's awesome. C.S. Lewis is one of my favorite authors, so I'll recommend Mere Christianity and Abolition of Man, and then you said Frank Sheed.
Frank Sheed, yeah, those are really good, solid Catholic things. It's important to get that they get a Catholic presentation. C.S. Lewis is good for the Apostles' Creed, basically.
Yeah.
He presents it so lucidly that it makes it so that it includes some of the world's arguments against Christianity generally in a very, very good way.
Yeah. If you want to hang on, Joseph, we'll send you Your Truth, My Truth, the CD from Carlo Broussard. Just fantastic. But I am going to keep moving because we're going to try to get as many as we can on this hour. And then if you're on the line, you can just hang on the line. We'll get to you next hour because Father's going to stay with us. Let's go to John in South Carolina, watching on YouTube. John, you there with us?
Hi.
Hi, John.
Hello, hello.
Hi. My question comes from viewing a bit of a sermon from the Venerable Fulton Sheen the other day. He was talking about the male priesthood and what a blessing it is, and he was very assertive about the maleness of it, and even compared it to the sexual act, and how the laity is feminine and the church is feminine. And it made me wonder how men can hold either the feminine role or the male role, but women can not hold that male role of priesthood.
Ah.
Well, the key point there is, and we won't talk about chromosomes. Well, women only have human chromosomes and men have both, but that's not the argument. We're not doing biological arguments in that sense, although that is interesting symbolically. But the fact is that the male priesthood, a priesthood which is reserved to males, is related directly to Christ and the Incarnation, and to the fundamental fact of human nature, which is God created man in his own image, male and female, he created them. Meaning, as we see in Genesis, it's very well presented there. God creates man, but the helper, which is suitable for him, he did not find, and God brought Eve out of man to be her be his companion. So human nature is, you could say, incomplete without both male and female. But so the marriage bond, when Adam says, this at last is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and then it goes on and says, for this reason a man shall leave his parents and cleave to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. That marital image, which is not just an image, it's the reality of human nature. That's where human beings come from, after all, is at the root of the Incarnation, because Christ is the fullest flower, the fullest realization of the fruitful love of our first parents all the way down to Our Lady's conceiving by the power of the Holy Spirit, that he's descended from Adam as the second Adam. And so the marriage image is at the root of all the sacraments in the sense of human existence and human destiny. And so when a priest takes on the role as being the leader or father of the Christian community in the person of Christ, the maleness is not insignificant. It's significant because he represents Christ in person as the incarnate God, as the bridegroom of humanity. Now, as a simple believer, the priest is as female in relation to Christ as any believer is, and Christ is neither male nor female. So as a simple believer, Christ is his bridegroom just like he's the bridegroom of every believer, all right? Because it's not a question of the sexual act. It's a question of the being rendered fruitful by the spouse of our soul. But in the sacrament, the priest's body symbolizes or indicates the presence of Christ in person as the head of the church and as the bridegroom, and therefore it's symbolically absolutely suitable and even required that he be male. And when we say symbolically, we're awfully affected by Protestantism sometimes. They go, well, only symbolically? That's not an argument. What do you mean? And you say, well, the Eucharist is a symbol. It's a symbol that's so powerful that it actually contains the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. The appearance of the bread and wine symbolizes body and blood, but they actually convey them. And the priest, when he says the words of consecration, he's identified as a sign of Christ's presence, offering his body and blood for the salvation of the world. And so there's that marital significance is there in the sense in which a man also gives his life to his wife so that the two can become fruitful together. Christ and the church, the priest and his people, going back to Adam and Eve. So there's a very deep connection there. And Pope John Paul II made it very clear he did not want to disturb that the depth of that connection. And he says the church is not authorized to change this discipline. C.S. Lewis, we were talking about in the last question, wrote an excellent, beautiful essay, probably the best you could read on women priests, in his set of series, The God in the Dock. He wrote in the 1940s. And he has an excellent argument, which could have been a document of the Holy See, explaining why men are priests and not women. And I really recommend that. But he also made the brilliant observation that Christianity without the distinction of the sexes might seem more just, but it wouldn't look very much like Christianity.
John, thank you very, very much for the question. Father Hugh Barbour is our guest, and he will be our guest the next hour. So if you're on the line, hang on the line. If you haven't called yet, ask a priest. And whether you are Catholic or not, whether you are Christian or not, if you have a question that you would like to ask a Catholic priest, you are welcome to call. 888-318-7884. We really want your call. Let me give it again. 888-318-7884. Be back in a few minutes, Father.
Great.
All right. We'll see you then, right after this. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As promised, Father Hugh Barbour here with us this hour. As we continue, ask a priest. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. I think everybody that's called so far has been Catholic. Has it been all Catholics? I don't remember if there was any non-Catholics that called, but I just want you to know the option's there for you. 888-318-7884. You were going to say something? No?
Nothing. No. We like non-Catholics, so.
We do like non-Catholics.
We do.
Yeah. There's only one thing that would make them better. Okay, I won't go there.
Well, we would hope it makes it better, but remember what our Lord said, you know.
What did he say? Tell me which one you're referring to.
Yes, we wanted to be good Catholics. We love God and neighbor.
Not to be whitewashed sepulchers.
Right, not to go across the ocean to make a convert and make him worse than yourself. No, we don't want to do that.
Where does that come from?
Our Lord said that to the Pharisees.
Don't go
across. Said you go across, you know, across the oceans and lands to make a convert, and you make him a devil worse than yourself, he says.
Oh.
Yeah, our Lord said some really interesting things to them. So that's always a warning for all of us who are right about everything. We are right about everything, but we've got to love everyone too at the same time.
Yeah, you know what? That's something I'm not always comfortable with the Catholics say. We've got the truth. And sometimes it's said almost in an uncharitable sounding way.
Well, maybe, but I mean, the point is that yes, I mean, if it's true, it's true, and you pronounce it as true, and you're not embarrassed about it, and you pronounce it, and you never say anything you know is not true. But truth requires the adherence of our will to the good, and the good is love. That's what love is all about.
Oh, you're saying this just the way
So we've got, as St. Paul says, doing the truth in love. All right, because truth without love, well, the devil has that. As St. Paul says, the demons believe and tremble.
Right.
So truth is necessary. Truth is our consolation, our bulwark, but that's so that we can be enabled to love with security and strength. And that's why we believe, because we love.
Man, Father, I'm happy you're back.
Got to. That's what Jesus said. I'm not making it up.
No, I wasn't thinking that you were making it up. That wasn't my impression. Elliot in Dayton, Ohio, listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Big Ohio day for us. Glad to have you, Elliot. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Father, I've had a job for a recent couple years at a Renaissance festival. And, you know, there's a lot of people that walk around there with pagan symbols, and, you know, like the pentagrams and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Just wondering, you know, should I be, you know, continuing to employ there? And, you know, I mean, I don't work or sell anything like that, but, you know, there are a couple shops with some other Catholics in there. And, you know, they might have some jewelry, like trinkets and rings and stuff like that. Have that, grabbing on that. Should they be, you know, they don't believe in it or anything like that, but should they be, will that put them in an occasion of sin or something like that?
I mean, you could never say with absolute certainty about any of these. You'd have to look at the actual circumstances. But I would say, in general, say you're at a Renaissance fair and they have all kinds of booths selling all kinds of stuff. And
right.
And one of them has esoterica, you know, has occult stuff or whatever, you know. It's the same thing as going down the street and shopping in one shop that's legitimate, and next door to it, renting from the same company that the other shop rents from, is a shop that sells, you know, esoteric stuff, you know.
Gotcha.
And so you're not contributing to their business by participating in that business district, you know, even though it's all in the same little economic system there. And
community,
right, exactly, that's the word. And so and also the Renaissance thing, it's people that are into things that seem pre-modern, and witchcraft and the occult and all that. There's a strong element of the pre-modern in it, you know, the pre-scientific or pre-modern scientific, you might say. And so people that they do it also because it's kind of ancient or different from modernity. And sometimes they don't always have evil intentions. But I think you dissuade people from all that sort of thing, but it wouldn't be enough to keep you from working there, I shouldn't think. I would just let it be. Quite different from, you know, if that was all they were doing, you know. And also, if you went to a market in Renaissance Italy somewhere, or France or whatever, you might find someone selling amulets to drive away the evil eye, or somebody doing potions of various kinds. You know, I mean, the thing is, those things have always existed, you know, palm readers, whatever. Those are things that Christians try to avoid, you know, predicting the future by disproportionate means and all that. But some of it is fairly innocent, like the potions are sometimes just natural herbal medications that produce an effect, like this coffee that I'm drinking, which can make you wide awake and irritable. And so it's like a potion. It does have an effect on my emotions, but it's not magic. Yeah. So
Elliot?
Yep. And, you know, there was a few of us talking about it, and then we wanted to come to a consensus there because, you know, we don't necessarily... if we're in a booth that sells that, I mean, not me so much, but even them, they were going to shy away and let someone else who doesn't care about that stuff do it. You know, they're already reaching that consensus, but we just want to make sure that we're not in an irritation or causing that type
right,
of
thing. Right. I would just, you can avoid it. That's reasonable and whatnot. And maybe suggest that they have some nice Christian things since the Renaissance was a very Christian era, just like the Middle Ages. You know,
all right.
Some Renaissance Madonnas, for example.
Thanks, Elliot. Appreciate the call. Hope that was helpful to you. Boy, lines continue full, though, and I'm going to keep moving. We're going to go to Oregon City, Oregon. Timothy in Oregon City, watching on YouTube. You are up next, Timothy. Go ahead with your question. Hi, Timothy.
Hello, Timothy.
Oregon City, Oregon.
Oh, hello, can you hear me?
Yes,
we can. Can you hear us?
Yes, thank you very much for taking my call.
Sure.
I appreciate it. So my wife and I were discussing last night, and our main question working through was salvation and the extent of Christ's mercy. Sorry, I was doing yard work, and I ran back to get
Sure, no problem.
I'm a little winded.
That's okay. No, good for you.
That's good.
Just, you're multitasking.
Yeah. So my wife brought up a question. So if you're saintly, you're pretty much perfect through the start of your life, and then the end of your life, which, you know, it's hard to tell when that is, you commit a mortal sin and you fail to make it to confession and you die. What happens to you? And my wife was also kind of questioning the polar opposite of that, is if you're horrible throughout your life, committing mortal sins, don't care, and then you do the confession at the end of your life, what happens to you then? And obviously,
wow,
we concluded maybe it does matter on your intent on the latter scenario.
Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of the basis of our questions.
Well, there are two things here. One is the absolute possibility of one or the other of the extreme cases that you mentioned. And they're both absolutely possible. That you could have a person who lived a very good life and didn't commit horrible sins and whatnot, and then just committed a horrible mortal sin and at the very end and didn't repent of it. That's possible, you might say. Okay. On the other hand, you can have a person that lived a horrible, sinful life and never had any thought for repentance or sorrow for sin, and then at the very end conceives a contrition and seeks pardon at the very end. So those two things are quite possible. But in general, you would say that, you know, that a person's life is a preparation for death, and that if you've lived a very good life, seeking God's will, loving God above all things, the chances of your committing a grave sin right before death are very, very slim. In fact, it'd be very difficult to understand. One might almost question whether or not it was fully grave or mortal, because mortal sin means it has to be malicious, not just a sin of weakness, but real malice, you know, that needs to be there. We have so much evidence that our Lord works with souls, and the devil also tries to the very end to get us to offend God and turn away from him, and he tries at the hour of death. That's why the prayers for the dying and the church's prayers for the dying are very clear about the presence of the devil and his efforts. But it's not like God is being mechanical about it. Like, oops, well, yeah, nice you had a pious life, but, you know, I've decided that, you know, I'm not going to help you out now that you failed me at the very end. He's not going to behave that way. Although, again, it's an absolute possibility. I mean, if Adam and Eve could fall in the garden when they were perfectly free from any sinful inclination, then that could happen to just about anybody. But we have the excuse of the weakness of our nature after the fall. And then the same with the person. More likely is the case where God pursues someone his whole life and doesn't respond very well, but then gives him the overwhelming grace of repentance at the end. That's what we have in the case of the good thief. And that's in our Lord's Passion. You see the extremes there is utter pardon to the good thief who was blaspheming him just a little bit before, according to the different gospel accounts. And then, of course, this Judas who received every consideration from our Lord and then took his own life in despair. Of course, the tradition is clear, as our Lord said, it's better for him that he had never been born. And that sounds pretty bad coming from the mouth of our Savior. But even with Judas, you know, there's not an absolute certainty. There's a certainty, you might say, from tradition, but not more than that. So we can't really enter into these mystical, mysterious aspects of God's working in the depths of souls. And so we hold out hope for absolutely everybody. I know of a case of someone who died in the right in the act of committing a sin. And that's a pretty horrifying thing. Still, we pray for that person and hope that they were given the instantaneous assistance of contrition. So that's my answer, so to speak. Is that sufficient?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank
okay,
you,
good. God bless you. Sure.
Thanks, Timothy. I like that. Doing the yard work, having theological discussions at
with
night.
Your wife.
That sounds like such a Catholic life. I
it's
like
nice,
it.
Nice, nice. Husband and wife discussing Timothy. Important things.
Do we do the break yet, or I have to do the break now? I got to do the break now? All right, let's take a break then. We'll be right back.
This is Bishop Chad Zielinski from the Diocese of Fairbanks of Northern Alaska, and you are listening to Catholic Answers Live.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Hi friends, Jonet Williams here. Join me every Wednesday on Women of Grace Live as I welcome New Age researcher and blogger for Women of Grace, Sue Brinkman. Sue and I will be talking about all the wacky things that could distract you from your faith. Psychics, yoga, Reiki, crystals, acupuncture, Ouija boards, tarot cards, and astral traveling are just a few of the stranger things we discuss. That's why we call it Wacky Wednesday. So join us tomorrow at 11 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
This is a book I am really looking forward to reading. I love Steve Weidenkopf's work. He's a very fine Catholic historian, and he's got a new book out called Light from Darkness. 9 times the church was in turmoil and came out stronger than before. And he's going to be on the show in 3 weeks, and if you want to be prepared with some questions for him, they've got a great early order deal on Light from Darkness at shop.catholic.com. Light from Darkness, 9 times the church was in turmoil and came out stronger than before. There's a deal on it right now at shop.catholic.com. Is it right to say, I often think that the pattern of death and resurrection in Christ's own life mm-hmm. is a pattern that the church lives through over and over again. Is that right to say that?
Yeah, because her whole life is marked by the mystery of his dying and rising.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. That's the logic of life, birth, death, and rising.
Yeah, so the church gets in these awful, awful messes
mm-hmm.
and then is reborn.
Right, exactly. It happens all the time.
All right. I'm a good theologian.
You are,
apparently. Kale in Kansas City, watching on YouTube. Hi, Kale.
Hi.
Hey.
Go ahead with your question, Kale.
So if we eat the body of Christ, which is Jesus, are we considered cannibals?
No, because it's a very, you could say, spiritually refined way in which we eat the body of Christ. That is, we believe that in the Eucharist, under the appearances or the sign or the symbol of bread, is present substantially and really the body of Christ, and under the appearances of wine is present really and substantially the blood of Christ. And with his body and blood, everything else about him which is united to that body and blood. And so he's there, his body and his blood, and together with his body and his blood, his soul and his divine divinity, his Godhead. So we receive the whole Christ when we receive his body in the Eucharist, but we receive it as substantially present. We don't receive it in its natural appearance. So that when we eat of the sign, that is of the sacrament, we're eating the symbol conveys to us his really and truly present body and blood and everything that goes with it, his soul and his Godhead. But we are eating him spiritually by faith and charity, but we believe him and we love him as really and truly substantially present. Okay, so it's a genuine nourishment of the soul by faith and charity because we have the merit and the love of accepting and believing and loving his substantial presence under those appearances of bread and wine. Now, that means that you're not literally chewing up his body and blood and the natural appearances, but rather you're receiving the outward sign of his body and blood, which you eat and drink by faith. Now, that's not the Protestant view where all you have is faith and he's not really substantially present.
Right.
We all know he's really there as truly as Cy is to me and I am to Cy sitting in this room together. We're substantially present to each other. But we, in addition, we have all of our other qualities, our bodily extension and whatnot. Whereas with our Lord in the Eucharist, he's substantially present as though he were sitting there with you, but not under the accidents of his bodily extension and all the accidental aspects of his human nature, which would be, if we were to eat him in his natural form, that would be what is entailed. So, but that's not what we do. So we're not functioning as cannibals. We're performing a very refined act of the Spirit in faith and charity, recognizing the presence of the Lord under those appearances of bread and wine.
Okay, Cale.
So, does that make sense?
Okay. Yeah, it makes sense.
Yeah, Thank you. just like you know when your grandmother kisses a little baby and says, "I could just eat you up," like they'd say in the South to my grandparents, "I could just eat you up," and gives him a kiss. Well, she's not really eating him up, but she's loving him to death and gives him a bodily sign of that. That's a weak image of what our Lord does in a stronger sense. We tell him we love him so much that we eat him up.
Yeah.
He says to do that. Yeah.
Cale, thank you very, very much. Appreciate the question. If you have a question for a priest, it's Ask a Priest today on Catholic Answers Live. 888-31-TRUTH is the number. Now we go to Illinois. Matt in Illinois, thank you for your patience, Matt. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Well, Cy, first I have to say this is a thrill. Typically, I will listen to you on the podcast, and it's so weird hearing you not on double speed.
Oh my gosh, people say that I talk too fast, just regular. I can't believe you listen on double speed. You're a hero.
Trent Horn is the worst. He talks too fast. But the second thing I'll say is that last week, multiple people refused your book, and I have to say, I think that's a venial sin. Now, I am not fishing for a book, but I'll just say I do live in the continental United States.
Wait, there was an earlier guy I was supposed to give my book to. Did I ever give it to him, Thomas, or did I forget to give it to that caller? That guy's got to call back. That guy that I promised the book to has got to call back. We failed. I messed up. But okay, Matt, you live in the continental United States. I'm fairly certain there is a free copy of my book coming your way. Just hang on after. Don't hang up.
That's so kind of you. It's so kind of you. I didn't expect that at all.
Oh, I'm sure you. I'm sure you didn't. Although you have to read it twice as fast as everybody else reads it.
I can do that.
All right.
Well, I'll get to the point, Father. It's a thrill to have you back. I have a pastoral question for you. Recently, noticed that a family in my neighborhood closed their young son in dresses, and I've been considering how to explain this to my son, who's closing in on two, and I'll need to start explaining these things to him. How do I explain these things to him while not engendering a hatred of a person, but also not dipping into relativism and maintaining his innocence?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, would your son know that this child dressed as a girl is actually a boy?
Yes,
he knows that he's a boy? Okay, well, and then you might want to wait until he asks you a question about it. He might come up with that. You know, if he doesn't ask a question, maybe it's not quite time to answer it. That's one thought. You have greater prudence than I do, and you'd say, no, I want to forestall this and explain it beforehand. But if it hasn't entered his mind, or he hasn't asked a question about it, it might not be the moment to bring it up. He might be something that he might ask more when he's three or four. Well, what do you think? I mean, this is a dialogue point. These are difficult questions.
Yeah.
Well, I don't he barely knows how to say what a cow says now. So he's getting there, but I'm just kind of planning ahead for when, you know, the inevitable.
Okay,
occurs.
Well, planning ahead, say when he's 4 or 5 or something, and he asks, or maybe earlier, you can just say that. You can say, I really don't know why they would do that, because he's a boy, and a boy normally dresses like a boy. So I agree with you. Whatever, what's your son's name?
Maximilian.
Okay, I agree with you, Maximilian. It's strange. It troubles me too, because it doesn't seem like it should be like that. And then you could move on to, there are some people who are confused, and they think that that they should be able to change what they are, even though they're a boy or a girl. They are confused, and they think that they can change to be a girl to a boy and a boy to a girl. You could bring that up, but I think I would first of all share in his perplexity, like, how strange is that? Or even ask him a question if you think he's wondering about it. Say, why do you think they do that?
Yeah.
See if he has any little answer in his little head about it, and then begin to explain it from the point of view of how he answers it, if you think he's really wondering about it. But I don't know if I'd bring the question up until it's actually brought up or it seems like it's becoming an issue. And it might be because other kids will mention it, and all kinds of things. But I think you can begin by expressing perplexity so that it's thoughtful and inquiring, and then move on to say there's some people are confused about this, and it's too bad that this happens, but you know, we have to be nice to them, and, you know, you can make the usual considerations that it's not a reason to mistreat someone or make fun of them, you know, and you make it clear you never should make fun of this person, because it may be something that's really hard for them. They're very confused, you know, something like that. I don't know.
Yeah, what do you think, Matt?
That's a great answer.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that's fantastic. I love the idea of sharing in his perplexity, because it's not, it's a teaching almost Socratically, you know, what do you think
right.
of that? I think that's a great answer. Thank you, Father.
Yeah, and you can also say, you know, like, you like to pretend you're a lion, or you like to pretend you're a bird, or you like to pretend you're a monkey, but it doesn't mean you're a lion, a bird, or a monkey. You know, that's you know. So,
right.
So,
Matt, thank you. I appreciate that. I'm sure that a million other parents are grateful that you asked, because it's interesting times that we live in. And we were saying with Rylene Simpson yesterday, who was on, got some questions about transgenderism and how do you respond, that she was saying that even among Catholics who at Courage, she was talking about Courage International, there's like a debate, because all this stuff is so new that you want to formulate the most charitable response, but you don't always know what that is. And I think these discussions are going to, and I don't think anyone should feel bad that I'm baffled. I don't know how to respond.
Right.
Well, you don't know how to respond because you're being put in a situation where it's hard to know how to respond.
And if you don't have a pause, then you might not be thinking about, first of all, this is a human being who's obviously terribly confused. And that means that in some level they're in some kind of pain. And so you need to address sweetly the question so that they will have your confidence, if it's possible, and listen to what you say, if you have anything to say about it. But although recently, just yesterday, the bishop of Kansas City, was it, yeah?
Bishop Nauman?
Okay. You know, put out a letter on...
I think you might be thinking of the Bishop of Arlington.
Or Arlington, Virginia. Excuse me, I'm confused. But, yeah, that's right.
I haven't read the letter yet, but I heard that it happened.
Arlington, Virginia, Bishop Burbage has put out a letter on the whole question of the transgender issues and sexual identity and all that. And it's the only one I know of in the American hierarchy, but it covers the issue very succinctly and well. And so you can get that on the website of the Diocese of Arlington, Virginia. Yeah. Right. So
Archbishop Nauman is our favorite bishop here, though.
But Nauman actually did one on pornography, I think.
Oh, did
he? Yeah, that was that's. But it's good stuff.
But he called yesterday. That's why he's our favorite bishop.
I know he called. We like bishops that's calling in.
Yes,
it's true.
I gotta say though, I think also you have to have compassion on these parents, because I think many parents are confused, and what. you know, 40 years ago, your child, a five-year-old boy, says, "I'm a girl." You go, it's a stage. You don't worry about it. Nobody gets upset about it. Nobody. But today, parents have all this pressure about, is my child transgender? Or some parents, they don't just have pressure. They have a kind of titillation. They get excited. Maybe I got myself one of these fancy transgender kids. Yeah. But, you know, there's nothing. A five-year-old saying to me, I'm a boy when they're a girl, or I'm a girl when they're a boy. This is not something to be worried
about. Well, that's what I was saying. It's children fantasize about all kinds of things.
Right, yeah, you know, right. Yeah. I'm a lion. I'm a dog. I mean, I had one of my kids was a dog for like 3 years. She thought she was a dog. and she's the sweetest kid, too. All right, we'll take a quick break. Matt, thanks for the call. We got to send Matt a free copy of A Teacher of Strange Things, a wonderful book about Jesus. We'll be right back with more Father Hugh Barbour right after this.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. It's free, and you'll have instant access to our daily broadcast, the schedule of upcoming shows, and you'll even be able to search the archive and listen to thousands of past shows. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Most of us Catholic parents agree our number one goal in life is to pass on the faith to our children. But here's the bad news. Today's world has a million ways to steal your kid's soul. Don't be afraid, says Father Sebastian Walsh. God loves your children even more than you do, and he desires their salvation more than anything. In his groundbreaking new book, Always a Catholic, Father Walsh shows you how to cooperate with God to bring about the fulfillment of his will for your kids. Always a Catholic reminds us that keeping our kids in the faith is about the way we live our Catholicism in our own lives and as a family from day to day. Order your copy of Always a Catholic by visiting shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Dr. David Anders here. Where is purgatory in the Bible? Why confess my sins to a priest?
Find out more tomorrow at 2 p.m. Eastern on Call to Communion.
Now, back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Father Hugh Barbour, our guest. And you can call with any question you'd like. You have a theological question, a question about prayer, family life, a moral question. Anything you might ask a priest about, you are welcome to ask. 888-318-7884. We're going to an anonymous caller in Pennsylvania, listening to EWTN, channel 130 on Sirius XM satellite radio. I like saying that. I feel very fancy. Anonymous, thanks for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Well, thank you, Father, and sorry for taking my call.
Sure, happy to.
I have a question regarding. Thank you. I have a question regarding the sin of vanity, and if plastic procedures such as Botox injections, fillers, or even plastic surgeries, is that a sin of vanity, and is it also reflect an attachment to the world, which is also kind of a sin?
Yeah, I would say it certainly can be. There's no doubt about it that it can be.
Sure,
A lot has to do with, whenever you undergo, especially a major surgery, you have to consider, is there a proportionate reason to undergoing the risk of this surgery?
Yeah.
Because there are some tragic cases of, like, you know, 40-year-old moms who leave this world because some surgery was botched.
Right.
And, you know, those kind of things. Now, that's extremely unlikely. with most of these procedures. It's extremely unlikely. So the proportionate argument is not so much there. I think that you're right to see that there's some danger there of a sort of a wasteful vanity, like to go to the expense for this very inconvenient procedure just in order to appear, as you think, appear a few years younger or to have larger breasts or whatnot, that might be something which you would spiritually say is not a healthy thing or not an indication of spiritual health. On the other hand, if someone is so emotionally tried by what is regarded as a physical defect that can be easily corrected,
sure.
Then they may have a good reason, emotional or psychological reason to do it. Like some women that have breast enlargements, they are so plainly endowed that it has become a problem in their life, and they just really, for their own emotional happiness, desire to do this. Now, I wouldn't automatically say that that's some kind of mortal sin or vanity. It might be a compensation or even an overcompensation for something that they've suffered under. But I think the people that are more guilty there would be the people that made them feel less than because they didn't appear a certain way.
Sure.
But I'd be careful not to be too hard on people in that case. Although, of course, the stereotypes are there, and they're not the stereotypes for a reason. That there's a certain, there's a certain beauty about a woman who just is beautiful in her youth and ages gracefully and doesn't try to fix anything that happens in nature that's simply the result of growing older. There was a great interview from the actress Jacqueline Bisset, for example, was a famous sort of bombshell of the
70s. But if you start out Jacqueline Bisset,
right, exactly. She's now 72 and she has this beautiful interview where she says, "I don't do anything." She said, "My wrinkles, I don't like them, but I accept myself the way I am."
Good for her.
Now, of course, she had years of,
being Jacqueline Bisset.
End up ahead of where most people started. Yeah. That's true. Right. But in any case, but she goes on to talk about her family formation and how there was nothing vulgar in her family formation, that there was nothing exaggerated or excessive in that. And I just thought, well, there you are. That's a good thing for a Hollywood actress to say, that she takes care of herself, she's in good health, and she looks beautiful for her age, without a doubt, and you can tell that she was an extremely beautiful young woman. And there's a beauty, a dignity to just growing old, looking like you should look.
Right, and there's also an indignity to kind of the desperate search for
when it goes too far. Now, I don't want a bunch of ladies. I live in Orange County, and there's a lot of that there.
Sure,
but I mean, it's fine. It's just that it's okay to question whether or not you really want to do this. And I think people that would be thinking really deeply about it, they might not do it. They might save themselves the money and the trouble. But I wouldn't say it's necessarily. I wouldn't automatically say it's a terrible sin of vanity. I'd say there are better uses for your money. You could help a lot of people in various ways, but and also there's some people that it's just a very slight thing, and some plastic surgeries are necessary because of injuries and whatnot. So I'd be a little cautious, and I'd just say I'd work on just not being vain myself, rather than being disgusted by people who are vain. And I think it is good to bring the question up. But there are people that will say, no, I felt so much better afterwards, and I feel better about myself, and I'm just not embarrassed. And, your body is yourself, and so sometimes people need a little help. That's why, what is a lot of bodybuilding if not a natural form of fixing your appearance? Because no one looks that way naturally.
I do.
Oh, okay.
Look at this.
All right.
Anonymous.
Just speaking as an expert.
This is natural. This is all natural. Seriously. Yes,
I think this is acquired. What I have is acquired.
Anonymous, is that helpful to you? Do you want to follow up?
No, it is helpful. I understand the concern for surgical procedures. It's more the injections or fillers, like Botox or fillers.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to do a sin of vanity or take myself away from God. So I understand what you're saying.
Well, if you are sensitive enough to feel like that you're not expressing your love for God or your confidence and trust in Him by pursuing that, then maybe that's something you don't need to do because you're getting a little inspiration that it's not something you need and that Jesus says, don't worry about it. Just be the way you are and I'll be happy with you and bless you. But say you're married and your husband says, I'd like you to get a little, facelift or something and you want one and he says it's okay and he's not unloving and awful, you know, maybe it's okay. But I mean, I think that it's not something I would recommend. It's like tattoos. I don't recommend tattoos either. I don't recommend any of these things. But I'm very afraid of just characterizing it as being automatically a great sin of vanity. That's all.
Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
And certainly if someone has some disfiguring...
absolutely.
And for especially for young people, it can be a terrible burden.
Like sometimes people had nose jobs, well, because they were embarrassed their whole life by the size of their nose, so they finally get a nose job.
And then they feel better.
They feel better. And granted, if they'd managed to live to older age with it, they would probably be proud of their big nose, but when they were young, it was a problem. And people judge by appearances, and depending on the business you're in, you know, it can be hard. So I think we just have a merciful judgment there.
Anonymous, thanks. I do hope that was helpful for you. Thank you very, very much for the call. I'm super defensive about this one because my father's a plastic surgeon.
Is he really?
Yes, right. So I'm very defensive.
Well, I had a hernia operation, and the doctor, it was an umbilical hernia, and he actually made me look better than
prior.
Yes,
good.
I won't go into the details, but let's just say
I appreciate that
something that other kids used to make fun of.
He took care of it. Yeah. Right.
The Audi anything, you know?
Yeah.
So
it was
I thought, I can't believe it. I didn't ask for it and I've had plastic surgery.
Yeah. Well, I mean, plastic surgeons do wonderful stuff.
Of course.
But I was I never knew what to do as a kid. You know, I'd be like at the mall and somebody would go, "Your father changed my life." I'd be like, "I don't want to know about it. I don't want to know whatever happened. That's between you and him."
Well, we had a confer and Abby had a terrible auto accident where his face was practically torn off.
Yeah.
And if they hadn't had years of experience in plastic surgery, even some of it cosmetic, they wouldn't have been able. They put it all back, and he looks exactly like himself.
Right.
And you barely tell that he had the horrible accident.
If I had that, I don't want to be put back the way I look now. I would like improvement. I mean, while you're there, doctor, come on. You can fix some of this.
They don't work miracles, though. Okay, it's art. It's art. It's not miracles.
But I also feel like sometimes, like the society puts unbelievable pressure on women.
Yes, absolutely.
And then makes fun of them if they fix something. I mean, leave them alone. Like, pick one. Pick a lane.
Well, I would say that it's women who make fun of other women more. I mean, I've seen a lot of that.
Yeah.
But I would just say, I think a lot of men who, if they love their wives and whatnot, they just say, "Honey, I'm happy with you. You know, I'm happy to grow old with you."
Right.
It's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I say that to my wife, and then I wait for her response. And nothing. Nothing from her on, "I'm happy with you."
But I know people who have plastic surgery.
Zero. Just silence. Yeah, right. I'm like, come on, dear. Like, I said it.
But I mean, I've seen there are people I know, very fine, devout Catholic women who've had some kind of plastic surgery.
Sure.
But it's not done so that you just go look at them and go, "Oh, she's had," you know, it's nuanced. It's, you know, done well.
Right.
So, but again, it's something where you have to make a moral decision on your own. And I don't think you could characterize as grave sin any kind of plastic surgery, you know, unless it's done with an evil intention. And I don't imagine that you could do that.
Right. Yeah.
Hardly. Hardly can imagine.
All right. We'll take a quick break. Be right back with more questions for Father. If you have a question for Ask a Priest, that's what we're doing. Ask a Priest right after this.
Hello, this is Archbishop Alexander Sample of the Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon. Keep that dial right here on Catholic Answers Live.
St. John Paul II stated that, for the disciple of Christ, evangelization is a duty, an obligation of love. And the Catechism of the Catholic Church states that evangelization is necessary for salvation.
So we know we're called, but how do we do it?
St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. To learn more, contact us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
EWTN has its own official YouTube channel with tens of thousands of videos covering just about every conceivable topic of interest to Catholics. And best of all, it's free. Every day, EWTN adds new TV shows, live events, devotionals, homilies, and specials to its YouTube channel. Visit the EWTN YouTube channel today. EWTN, the Global Catholic Network.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Father Hugh Barbour, our guest, and you can probably tell I'm always really happy when Father's here, but especially now. We've missed you, Father.
Well, I mean, here I am.
There's
like a bad penny, I just come back around.
Yeah. Is that I don't know what that means. I hear people say that bad penny thing, but what is a bad penny? I don't even know.
Well, no one uses pennies anymore anyway.
Oh, yeah.
So, yes, but it's...
Right. I think we should just get rid of the pennies. Why do we even have the pennies? Just round it off to a nickel, and we'll forget about the penny.
I'm opposed to that.
You're opposed? Well, you're such a conservative.
I'm a traditionalist.
No, really. I know I'm a wild-eyed liberal because I want to get rid of the pennies. Well, I mean, sorry, Father.
I didn't say that, but I'm just saying, you know, for heaven's sakes, what are you going to do? You can't go to the grocery store anymore and throw it all in that machine and get cash for it.
Oh, I love that machine,
too. Yeah, those
too.
Are fun, yeah.
I love the machine that just counts up your money. And then
it takes the stuff in the car caddy and just go in.
And then takes 10% of it and gives you a voucher.
Yeah.
Daniel in Texas, listening to EWTN Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Oops, hang on. I got to make sure I'm pushing the right button here, Daniel. Sorry. Go ahead, Daniel, with your question for Father.
First, my children love pennies, so I have many uses for them.
Oh, you would go down on Father's side.
Hey, I gotta go with the
priest,
the guy with the cool order. Not
that's right.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So my question is, what is a Norbertine, and how are they different from like other monastic orders, such as the Benedictines, Cistercians, Trappist, etc.?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, a Norbertine, of course, that's sort of the popular name for our order because it was founded by Saint Norbert, just like you say Dominicans because of St. Dominic, or Franciscans because of St. Francis. But all those orders have names which are not the names of their founders. Like the Franciscans are the order of friars or brothers minor, and the Dominicans are the order of preachers, and we are the order of Prémontré. That is, we were founded in Prémontré in north eastern France, and so by St. Norbert in the 12th century. And we are not monks, strictly speaking, although the word monastic is a generic term that's used for all religious orders, but the word monk is specifically used only for those who follow the monastic rules of St. Benedict or St. Basil the Great and some other monastic rules in the Syrian church, for example. But we are in the category called canons regular. And we are the original diocesan clergy of the church in the time of St. Augustine in the 4th century and 5th century, where the bishops required the clergy of their diocese to live in common with them in an episcopal monastery, where the bishop was the superior and he might have had another to run the community, sort of a charge of the community. And the priests and clerics of the diocese lived in common with the bishop and they served the people, but out of a clerical monastic community. In which all the priests were celibate, of course, but also they held all their property in common. Now, this ideal, which was upheld in southern France and in northern Italy, and especially and in North Africa with St. Augustine, it dwindled a bit in the sense that the clerical communities continued, but the priests became proprietary. That is, they began to hold their own property, and although they maintained celibacy and they had certain common prayers and whatnot, they no longer had that common life based upon a commonly held property. And so when Pope St. Gregory the VII wanted to reform the clergy in the 11th century, in the 1000s, he began a movement to retain and maintain celibacy, but also to get the clergy to live in common and to practice common property, that is poverty, common poverty. And that was not so successful. The celibacy part, yes, but it was very difficult to get the diocesan clergy at the time to buy into the whole thing of being not possessing property but possessing it in common. That's based upon the Acts of the Apostles, of course. They held all things in common and no one called anything his own, but distribution was made to each according as each one had need. That was the ideal given in the Acts of the Apostles. So that was what St. Augustine, St. Ambrose, St. Caesarius of Arles, Paulinus of Nola, all these ancient fathers followed. So in that context with St. Gregory the VII and the so-called Gregorian Reform in the 11th century, the common life aspect was not that successful. There have been attempts to restore it under Charlemagne way back in the 800s, 700s, and 800s, in the Carolingian period. But finally, what happened was those clergy who were from that diocesan context who wanted to live monastic life, common life together, in addition to celibacy and have the common prayer and all of that, they began to group together as they had earlier reform their clerical life according to that model of the Acts of the Apostles. And so that's the Norbertines, for example, we're from that, the Canons Regular of the Holy Cross, and different Canons Regular in Central Europe, in the Austrian congregation, and in Germany and other places, Hildesheim. But we're the largest group of them. We were very large in the Middle Ages, up to 20,000. But basically what we are is a priestly community, a clerical community, whereby we have all the observances of a common monastic life, the divine office, the hours of the divine office, common meals, common possessions, common apostolate, working together. And so we don't look much different from Benedictines who might have an active apostolate. We don't look much different from them, but we follow a different rule because we follow the rule of St. Augustine, which was written precisely for clerical religious, those who are going to be priests, deacons, bishops, even acolytes, lectors, those men in the early church. And so that's our ideal. So it was the original ideal of the diocesan clergy, which later on had to become a kind of a religious order because the diocesan clergy in general were not ready to adopt that model of common life. More and more today, there are many diocesan priests who see that they really need to live together. And maybe it won't go as far necessarily as holding their property in common, but to have that common life, which is very, very necessary if you're also going to live a life of prayer and of accountability and especially of celibacy. So that's what we do. So we do anything that a diocesan priest would do, but we do it in a context of a common monastic life.
Okay, Daniel.
That's an awesome answer. Thank you.
Okay. God bless. Thank you. Thanks. Sure.
I'm just going to keep moving because we'll try to get as many as we can on here. We'll go to Indianapolis, listening on EWTN.com. Jim in Indianapolis, go ahead with your question for Father.
Hello. Yes.
Hello, Jim.
Yeah. With all respect, I just want to say that I also have a face for radio.
All right. Well, congratulations on that.
My question is that all of the explanations of annulment I've heard are based on Paul's letters rebuking someone who took a second wife who was also his stepmother.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
And I'm just wondering if there's anything about annulment for a first marriage that we can look to.
Well, it's our Lord's words where he says that if a man divorces his wife and marries another, he commits adultery. And then he says, porneia, which means in that case an invalid marriage, is a separate case, all right? Accepting porneia, which means sometimes translated accepting fornication, basically that he's referring to just that case, that a marriage which is not a valid marriage in the first place. And so in that case, to separate or to have that bond which didn't really exist, to be recognized as not existing, is okay. So our Lord, when he absolutely prohibits divorce and remarriage, he says, of course, it's a separate case if that first marriage is invalid, in which case it wasn't a marriage at all, and of course the person is free to marry. In the case with St. Paul, it was more or less a disciplinary thing in the early church and on for some time, and still there are remnants of it, especially in the Eastern churches, that second marriage was regarded with toleration, you might say, in the early church. There was a very strong opinion in favor of widows and widowers remaining so and not remarrying. And St. Paul says, well, if they're young, yeah, they probably should remarry, but generally they wanted the widows who were older and had raised their families to live kind of like a consecrated life, you know, in a category of widows in the local church, devoting themselves to prayer and charity, and not to engage again in marriage. It was regarded as like, well, that they're unable to maintain continence without marrying again. And so there was kind of a disciplinary prejudice in favor of having only one marriage, even if the first marriage ended by death. But the church always allowed those second marriages, but it was kind of regarded as a concession to human weakness. And so, and of course, in the case of the man who married his stepmother, well, that's a further outrage because, of course, he entered into a marriage which was not regarded as valid, and it wouldn't be valid even according to church law today. And so because the church can prohibit certain unions based upon the relationship pre-existing between the two persons that want to unite. So that's a separate case. But in the Eastern churches, they even have a kind of a penitential marriage ceremony for second marriages. So like in the Eastern Orthodox Church, where they do allow divorce and remarriage, the bishop approves it. The second ceremony, I've been to such a ceremony. It's done for widows, widowers, but also for divorced people. And the priest prays, "O Lord, have pity on your servants who have been unable to bear the heat of the day and the lust of the flesh." I mean, it's actually a penitential ceremony, like asking for mercy that, sorry, we can't help it, but we got to marry again. So it's not something that would go over too well in today's culture. And in fact, they have a little crisis with that, because now that these things are translated into modern English, people go, what? what do you mean? You know? There is that early Christian idea that, well, you know, you had your marriage now, so now it's time to live a quiet life of contemplation and charity as you prepare for death. You know, that was kind of the attitude. But our Lord mentions the annulment implicitly by mentioning the case of an invalid first marriage.
In Matthew's Gospel,
right,
Matthew's
chapter
Gospel,
19. Right,
chapter
19, right.
Does that help you, Jim?
It does. I just don't understand where it says, okay, you can not be with that person, but where does it say you can be with another person?
Well, the thing is, if he precisely says you can't divorce your first wife and marry another, because that would be adultery. But if the first marriage was never valid, if it wasn't a true marriage, he says that's a separate case. Basically, he says, but an invalid marriage is a separate case, meaning now that would mean someone would have to determine that the marriage was invalid. That would be, they'd have to go to authority to resolve that. But that's in the case where there's an annulment simply means that marriage that's annulled, it's declared null, meaning that it was not, there was some impediment to it being a true marriage bond. Something restricting their freedom, or some defect in their intention or their sincerity that made it so that it couldn't be a genuine mutual bond of the two people, in which case they were not truly married. And if they were not truly married, that can be declared, and then at least one of the parties is free to marry again. Sometimes if the invalidating condition was very, very grave, the party that caused it might be forbidden to marry without permission in the future, just to make sure that they don't make the same mistake again. But our Lord mentions that case, because in that case, there was no marriage to begin with.
Thanks, Jim. I'm going to move Dave in Fort Wayne, listening on Redeemer Radio. You got to be real quick if you'd like an answer.
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Father, thank you for taking your call. And also, my question is a priest in persona just during the transformation of the blood and host, or is he during communion also?
Well, that's a very good question. I would say that you know, in the absolute strictness, the thing that only a priest can do is the place where he's acting most strictly in persona Christi, in the person of Christ, and in consecrating the bread and wine and in receiving the fruits of that sacrifice himself in Holy Communion, the priest's communion. But then the rest of the liturgy is a build-up to that, and so he's functioning in persona Christi the whole time, but it's in order to build up to that moment, which and where he performs his function most strictly or most properly. Like in a marriage, you know, the man and wife or husband and wife all of the time, and they're taking care of their family all of the time, but when they actually procreate a new life, that's when they're most strictly or intensely functioning as man and wife, even though they're man and wife at every other point. Same with the priest leading the liturgy. He's in persona Christi in view of that consecration and bestowing the fruits of that consecration on the people. So he's always in persona Christi, but most intensely at the moment of consecration.
Thank you, Dave, for that question. Thank you to everyone who called. Father Hugh Barbour has been our guest. Father, may we have your blessing before we go.
Benedictio Dei Omnipotentis, Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos et maniat semper.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Yeah.
Very, very pleasant to have you back.
Good to be back.
Doing
yeah.
2 hours. Okay. Are you going to be tired now? Does that wear you out?
No.
No. You just like being a priest.
I can go on talking forever, you know.
Yeah, I guess. That's probably
just
true.
Just turn the lights out. I'll just keep.
Who we got tomorrow? You want to tell me who we got tomorrow? And I'll tell the. We don't know. We got. Tomorrow is a good show. I am remembering now. Tomorrow is a Wednesday show, and we've got guests. And that is going to be great when we have guests tomorrow.
And mystery guests.
Right now they're a mystery. Oh, it's Father Maccone. We're going to do Ask a Priest again with this. You know Father Dave Maccone?
Yes, yeah,
of course. He's a superstar.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful.
See you then.
Great.
God willing.
Come back.